Welcome to the STABcast, a podcast dedicated to Star Wars Legion. Greetings, cadets and commanders, and welcome to the STABcast, the Sun Sphere Tactical Attack Brigade's Legion podcast. I'm Ryan Disarray Slowoski, joined tonight by Will Breakthrough Heim and Ben Clear Conditions Fowler. How are we doing today, boys?
Doing fine.
Doing pretty good.
Good to hear.
This week on STABcast, battle reports from our fun of the tables, a continued look at Turn Zero, e-webs and laser emplacements, and much, much more.
It's been a little while since we've brought you guys an episode, and in that interim, I have gotten to play a ton of Legion. Not a whole lot of casual, but a ton of competitive. I got to make it out in the past couple weeks to two local recruitment kits and had an absolute blast. So we had our local event in Knoxville and then another event here in Kingsport. Ben, you were our glorious TO in Knoxville. What were your impressions and how did it go and how was your day?
It was a good day. We had an uneven number of players, and you know my stance on when there's an uneven number of players. I was hoping an extra guy would show up after round one, and it didn't happen. So everyone was having fun, and I decided I would just TO for the day. I hated to knock someone out, because normally, according to the buy rules, you put someone down who didn't win, and I feel bad about putting a person who didn't win to not play another game when you're only playing three for the day.
Right.
So I took a break. I watched. I answered questions. I took a lot of photos. I uploaded them up to our Instagram. It was good. I kind of needed a break myself. The end of school year has been rough for me, so it was just nice to relax and watch people have fun and try to talk about the game to people who walk by. I always try to sell when we're playing. Always try to sell. Because if I can get more people playing the game, that's better for me as a player.
So have you at least gotten to play any casual in the week since our last show?
I got one game in against Tim, a friend of ours. It was an Imperial v. Imperial training exercise because we were both running very similar lists, same models, but different upgrades on them, and had intercept transmissions, and it was a tight battle. We went to time on it because the store was about to close on us, and we got to round, I think, five, and I beat him by just a couple of points there. If we'd had 35 more minutes, I think Tim takes the thing, whittled me down hard, but I had scored just enough points on round two and round four to keep me above the lead, so... It was good. Tim and I talked about what went well, what went wrong. He had some bad dice, he did. I had some bad draws from my order deck. Things I didn't need. I was like, oh, look, there's Vader being pulled first thing. That's not a good thing.
Right, yeah.
It was a good game. Like I said, Tim and I had lots of fun, enjoyed ourselves, set up a nice map. That's all that really matters.
Good deal, good deal. Will, me and you both got to play during the Knoxville tournament, so I guess we'll go round by round. How'd your first game go, Will? Tell us in great detail.
Oh, I'm sure you're very interested. But before I go over that, I'll just kind of briefly describe the list I was using that day. It was Darth Vader with the usual upgrades, two snowtrooper squads with flamers, and then four trooper squads, two with DLTs, one missile, one naked, and two bikes was my list.
Lots of variety.
Yeah, running the single commander to see if Vader could hold his own. So, round one, it was the STABcast fight between Ryan and myself.
Yeah!
Now, I will say, as TO, it was completely random. I pulled them from separate piles.
I don't believe you. It was rigged. I think we were playing Disarray and...
Yeah, Recover Supplies.
Yeah. My first turn, I used this play I'd thought up where... You use Vader's 2-pip and kind of run out there and grab a crate on the first round, which I think bothered Ryan a little bit, but...
Yeah, it was nasty.
After that, it kind of turned away from me there. I made a few mistakes with moving units at the wrong times, and I had a lot of suppression tokens that I couldn't really deal with very well. And I think Ryan can fill in the rest.
So, like Will said, game one, we got to play each other. We played it on this kind of weird, slopey battleground where Will, I think, definitely had the deployment edge because he had a lot more heavy cover in the corners that he got to deploy in Disarray. And we were playing limited visibility, so it meant you could go and grab those crates in the early turns with, like, little repercussion. So I kind of... bolted out to the middle of the map real quick and tried to contest three of them when I saw that he was just going to take one and run away with it with Vader's 2-pip, new ways to motivate them. I normally, with my list, which I guess I'll talk about here in a second, like to play Leia's one pip card really early turn one, but I couldn't due to limited visibility. So I kind of kept Leia in this really weird corridor where she was threatening Will's speeder bikes at range two when he came to swoop in to try to clear out one of my flanks that he didn't commit a whole lot of infantry to. But Leia's really good at murdering speeder bikes. But then she also, since we were on disarray, had the horizontal, the long angle shot down the middle of the map because there was a big piece of blocking terrain kind of in the center. So she was kind of threatening two directions that turn. And Will misplayed his bikes a little bit and got them picked off probably a couple of turns before he really wanted to. And I think that was, we traded pretty well everywhere else, but I think me crushing that one flank without having to commit a whole lot of resources with enough time to still bring those forces that were on that one flank over to the middle of the map after I had secured the two crates that were over there kind of swung the game in my favor. But I was running a double commander Luke and Leia, with Luke having mind trick and reflexes, Leia having environmental gear. And then I had four squads of rebel troopers with the extra body, but no heavy weapon. And then two squads of fleet troopers. I think we talked about on a previous episode, or maybe it was on one of our live streams, about the discussion between the fleet trooper shotgun and the fleet trooper grenade launcher. And as I was continuing to think about that, I came up with a really cool combination that's the best of both worlds, because Pierce is really good and the consistency of the red dice and not having to reload it from the shotgun. Or there's the grenade launcher that gives you blast. And when you throw that many dice, blast is really, really good, especially since they're pretty inconsistent dice. So I was running these fleet troopers with the extra body, the shotgun, and concussion grenades. I think Will can tell you that it's pretty nasty when they get to range one, because they just kind of roll up, throw 8 white dice, 2 red dice, 1 black die with Pierce 1 and Blast. And it's really nasty.
My bikes did not enjoy it.
Yeah, I think on several occasions over these couple battle reports, they got in there and got to one-shot entire squads. It was pretty, pretty gross. So that was my list. I managed to bring Will down showing who's the superior Stabcast player in a 4-0 victory. I couldn't quite get to the box that he ran away with, but I did manage to pick the trooper off and he dropped it. So that was nice, moving up to 1-0. So, Will, how was your game 2 after your big helping of Humble Pie?
Humble Pie. All right. Well, round 2, I played Chris Hodge, who's a local guy, plays a lot of games with us. And we did Long March with Secure the Transmissions and Rapid Reinforcements. That's what it was. Rapid Reinforcements on Long March is really interesting to have to play around because there's a lot of space. He was playing like a super mechanized rebel list. He had 3 ATRTs and a snowspeeder.
Oh, wow.
The problem was he had minimum troops. He only had 3 squads of rebel troopers. So I came into the game with an advantage on number of activations. And during deployment, he chose to put 2 out of his 3 rebel squads into the rapid reinforcements card.
So he only had his commander and 1 squad on the board, yeah.
Yeah. And I told him, you know, you can put 0-2 on there. And he's like, no, I want to put 2 so I can, like, show up later. And I'm like, oh, okay, let's see what happens. And I put 1 snow trooper squad with a flamer in there because I wanted that to appear kind of behind his backline trooper squad he kept on the first objective. And we just ended up kind of slowly approaching each other. He sent his, you know, snowspeeder out really fast, and my guys just shot it down. And then Luke and Vader had a stick fight. Neither of them died.
How does neither one of them die? He just ran out of time?
They just kind of waved their sticks at each other. They both had really bad dice. Like, Luke, son of Skywalker, and did no damage to Vader.
Ooh.
Oh, no.
But then Vader does his implacable to attack twice and then does, I think, 1 or 2 to Luke. Well, it's like whenever I would roll hits, he would roll a bunch of blocks or vice versa. You'd just roll a bunch of blanks. It was a bunch of hot garbage.
That's pretty funny.
I ended up winning. I had all 3 capture points on round 4, and then we knew the time would run out in round 5. So we just called it there since you only score on the even rounds anyway.
Cool. My game 2 was against Chase Arnold, a local transplant who's hanging out with us for a little while in the area. Me and Chase had an interesting game, and I want to preface this by saying, like, Chase is a really solid player. He's a really good dude, but that was one of the most frustrating games of Legion that I've ever played, and not for the reasons that you might initially think. Chase is a super nice guy, but we played a very, very slow game. By the time setup was done and we started playing, we had 3 minutes left in the round when round three started, and we just decided to call instead of making everybody else wait because we were the only game still going. We played intercept transmissions with limited visibility. Or no, we had hostile environment. Intercept transmissions, hostile environment, battle lines. The board was a little bit off, which meant that he could get to the cent within range of one of the points with one activation, and it took me two. So he had a bit of an edge there, which I guess probably just one of the objective pieces got moved or something like that, because it shouldn't have. But that's my fault for not measuring. But I was a little disappointed that we got so little game under our feet. And I don't think, you know, and I'm not going to say I don't think, I know that Chase wasn't doing this maliciously or to try to squeeze a win out. He's just a very thoughtful, a very tactile guy. And so that's how he wants to play the game. And I'm never going to tell anybody that the way that they want to play with their game is wrong. But my strategy using, you know, lots of flamethrowers, I had two flamethrower ATRTs, two groups of fleet troopers that need to be close. Luke, who's pretty well kitted out with mind tricks, so he needs to be close. I didn't get to the stage in the game where I really get to turn my list on. So Chase brought a very long range list, fielding a bunch of rebels, five rebel troopers, double commander like me with a few different upgrades, but he had two ATRTs with heavy laser cannons while I had flamers. And so I would have really liked a couple extra turns to close the gap and close the distance. And he's a very thoughtful guy, but it's the only game of Legion where I was like actively bored. I was like wandering to other tables to like see how things were going, because once again, he's a very thoughtful guy and I don't want to take that away from him because that's how he enjoys to play the game. And so I took a loss. It was a pretty close game. He definitely had the army advantage because I had to do more running towards him. But I think given another couple turns, both my ATRTs were still standing. I had Luke about to mind trick some people off the board because he made an absolutely incredible. I managed to get four suppression on a group of his troopers, and they managed to rally all four of them off in a turn that would have made them flee the battlefield. It was a pretty frustrating game. Chase is a good guy. I'd happily play with him again. But I guess as a word of advice to people like that, be sensitive on both sides of the table to your opponent. Like, I need to be sensitive that he wants to really think about every decision and play at a slower pace. But also, if you're that slower paced player, watch your opponent's body language, see how they're interacting. And if you're taking a little too much time, maybe try to pick up your pace, because at the end of the day, while this is a competition, everybody's there to have fun and play with tiny plastic men or women or aliens or droids, like whatever your fancy is. That was game two. It actually tied. We went 1-1. Since at the end of the game, we would score those again. So it would have been 3-3, but he definitely destroyed more of my army because I didn't have a chance to quite close the distance. It was a good, hard-fought game and a humbling, humbling loss. So I went down to 1-1.
This is a good place to talk about setup time, since setup time is part of the round itself. I noticed a lot of players were taking 15 plus minutes to move their models to the table states, get their battle cards ready, get that figured out, and then start deploying. I'd say half the games took 20 plus minutes to actually get started. The other half were done in 10. And so they got more game out of it because they were trying to set up and move as fast as they could. I would go around to tables and just throw battle cards down so that they could then make their decisions quickly and then help scoop it up and get out of the way so they could move a little bit faster.
I will say this, most of our players are relatively new, and this is the first time any of them had used the battle card system, like of vetoing and picking cards that way. We did have the tables set up, and a lot of our guys like hadn't really been out that much before. But I will say, even with the 2-hour round limit, most of our games were done in that window. I think my game went to time and maybe a couple others over the course of the day. So I think 2 hours is fair, especially as players get more accustomed to how setup should work.
I definitely would look at ways of getting your army moved around tables very quickly. Pans are always nice and fine to do, things you can kind of pick up. clean up as you go, I think, helps you move between tables faster.
Bring a baking tray if you've got one. I've got a little wooden box that I bring so that I can quickly move stuff in.
So, Will, what about game three?
Yeah, game three, I played against Tim, which Ben's already talked about playing him in casual night. It was another Imperial on Imperial training match, and we were on the corporate retreat planet, as Ben called it.
Had a beautiful lagoon, had a nice little lake, and...
Mm-hmm. It was very nice until we littered it with bodies, because this game was an absolute bloodbath. Ben was kind of hovering, because I think he was horrified by the display we were putting on. It was crazy. We were just trading units. At one point, we had, I think, 7 or 8 trooper units on the board that were just unit commanders.
I want to say you or Tim had, I think, 8 minifigures and 5 units. Like, that's how decimated the troops were. And you just have a unit commander just marching across the board.
What objective were you guys playing?
The one where you just grab them at the end of the game. What's that called?
Key positions?
Yeah, key positions. Yeah, we just fought each other, and then, like, round 6, our limping trooper unit leaders are like, oh, there's a tree over there I have to sit in. Tim ended up thwarting my round 6 objective grabbing, and I think he won 2-1. But it was super close. Some rally rolls go the other way. It could have gone either way. It was a lot of fun.
There's some gross panic on both sides.
So round 3, I got to play Dustin Harvey, local Maryville player, fabulous painter. And he's the guy who, from Jagged Brush Studios, that supplied us with some awesome minis to give away for our ugly painting contest. We had a really interesting game. Dustin hadn't really gotten, no, he had gotten, I think, 1 game in before this tournament. So I was playing like him on his 4th game of Legion. And he definitely made some rookie mistakes. And I played like a learning game because I knew I was out of the running from losing in round 2. So I just said, you know what, let's have a good time. And I don't know if it was karma or what. Dustin made a few mistakes. So I think I should have won the game just based on my experience and how we played the game. But it shouldn't have gone the way it did. My dice could do no wrong and his dice could do no good. It was absolutely gross. We didn't do any shooting turn 1 or any meaningful shooting. But I think in turn 2, I got 2 activations off the board before they could really do anything. My dice just warmed up super hot. Like, Luke kept trying to run in and kill things, but they would be dead before Luke could get to them. And so I literally shoved him into one little tiny corner of the map. We were playing Recover the Supplies, and I managed to take the game 5-0. It was pretty gross. I think we called it at the end of round 4 because it was... like 9 activations to 3, and everyone else was close to done. And we, well, like I said, I was playing very slow as a learning game, saying, hey, instead of taking this action, maybe you should do this or consider this. You can split your fire here. And we had a good time. Dustin was a great sport. I will say that I would not have been as cool, calm, and collected as him if the variance would have gone so strong one way or another. So Dustin's a good guy. And I ended the day at 2-1, and I think I managed to pull down 2nd place.
That dice, I was standing there when you threw it. I was like, oh my God, did that happen? And he blanked out in defense. I mean, it was the grossest thing possible.
It was really gross. He had flame troopers, flame snow squads that never got to shoot. It was pretty dumb. I punked Vader off the board pretty easily without Luke. It was just like troopers shooting at him and he died. It was pretty silly.
Vader made a run for a trench to hop in for the cover and didn't make it.
He did make it in, and then I didn't get him with just troopers. He had like 1 or 2 health left. And then Luke jumps on top of the trench, and I shout, I have the high ground, roll a bunch of dice, and Vader dies. It was a fun time. So I think Chase, my round 2 opponent, ended up taking down the tournament, so big congrats to him. We had a really solid turnout. It was, what was it, like 12 or 13 players?
It was 13.
13 including you. So we had 6 tables going. It was a really good turnout. Our local store had a bunch of D&D tables going on in the background, and they kept like wandering up to see what we were doing because we had all this cool terrain and we were shouting, and it was a pretty cool event. So big congrats to Chase for winning. Big thank you to Ben for running it. Big thank you for Will for the strength schedule boost. Uh-huh.
I don't know if I gave you a strength schedule boost.
Yeah, you really didn't. You lost to Tim. Let's be real here.
Yeah, strength of schedule is really odd. Like, you have to use the computer for it, and I did not use the computer that day. And so I sat down with another player and we kind of looked at numbers and We looked at victory points and how many wins and how many wins did the other guys have and ranked them all out. And that's how you end up in second. So it's the fact that your opponents had won more games against other people.
Right.
And you had won more games.
It was a really fun day.
Great day. I say great community out here. And it's fun to listen to the D&D guys shout things as we shout things. And sometimes we shout things at each other.
Yeah, that's a lot of fun.
So our tournament went great. So last weekend, Ryan got to go to Kingsport in an attempt to hold on to the Knoxville dominance of the Upper East Tennessee area.
It went pretty good. For the 500-point battle, I managed to go and take down Kingsport and, you know, show them where the power in East Tennessee is. So I had to go defend my title. Eric Maynard at Dwayne's World Games put a fantastic show on. I want to say we had 15 players show up. It was a really good day. Some friendly faces, some faces I hadn't met before. We had people from Knoxville. We had people come from Chattanooga. We had players from Asheville. We had players from all over. It was a really good turnout. It was a cool day. My first game, I got to play Drew from Chattanooga, who came to our event the previous week and was running a list almost mirror list to me. He had less upgrades on his fleet troopers, but more upgrades on his ATRTs. Instead of flamers, he had rotaries. But we were both running 10 activation lists, and so we didn't know how this was going to go because we both like to play this out-activate-you style. And kind of like my game against Dustin, I made a few better plays than him because we played Intercept the Transmissions on Disarray with Hostile Environment. And he pretty much ignored the middle point, so I only had to commit one unit to go grab those victory points up there. We went the full distance. We got to play all six rounds. It was a bloodbath, and his dice could, once again, my dice never failed. His dice never hit, and he didn't, like, I won 11-0, which is gross, but the game should have been a lot closer to that. He played a really clean game. He played a good game. He played a smart game. I think he messed up the first turn a little bit by he waited for me to move forward and then moved up to shoot me, which is fine, but he didn't really get a whole lot of damage done, but it meant he was an action further away from getting into transmission intercepting range at the start of round two, and I was able to suppress him down to where he couldn't do it. So I got a bit of a tempo edge going into the first score.
So let me ask you about intercept transmissions. Is it better just to run up there and just weather the fire?
Yes, absolutely. I'm going to say as Rebels, take a dodge token to use that nimble keyword to make sure that if you only need one action to get within range one on turn two when you go to score, you've got it. You're there. Even if you don't get to shoot, if you're suppressed down, you can make sure that you get there. On the first turn, I got a bunch of suppression down with Leia's orbital bombardment. I kind of did the goofy thing where we were playing on a pretty open table. And to where I peppered everything that was away from his Leia, and he shot his Leia the same turn at me, but he shot my Leia and two units next to her. And then he activated first, and I cleared that suppression away with Inspiring, and then Leia rallied her own. So I got a definite edge there. Once again, like I said, my dice didn't fail. The score was pretty close to a wipe. And the table was too, but he only made, I think, one or two big errors, and the game should have been a lot closer. But man, he was a great sport and great spirits. So I give him a lot of kudos because I wouldn't have been that collected. I put my troopers on crate for a reason. I'm a pretty salty guy. Round two, I played Chad Dickerson, who runs the Asheville Guild Ball group. Really cool guy. I know some other gamers here in Knoxville who are affiliated with him, and it was cool to get to meet him. I'd heard some good things about their Guild Ball group. So we got to eat lunch together after round one and then get back to the store, and surprise, we have to play. Once again, we played Disarray Recover Supplies with Hostile Environment, and I showed him the power of Fleet Troopers. I don't think he had any Fleet Troopers in his army. He had opted for more Z6s and more upgrades, so I had an extra activation on him. And through some clever positional play, I managed to squeak a win out 3-0, making him drop a couple of key boxes. I had one flank really go my way. We kind of decided to trade flanks with Disarray, and he took one flank, I took one, but I crushed one very quickly, and so I could move those units to the middle of the map and help support. While I used Leia's handing out dodge tokens and the nimble keyword and some really good fleet trooper and ATRT rolls when they got just their one or two shots off really, really well to slow his roll to where he couldn't just take that flank in two or three turns. It took him pretty much the whole game to secure it. So I ended up taking that game. Chad was a good sport. He learned a lot. We both learned a lot, and we had a good time. And I look forward to going up to Asheville if they get some Legion events together and joining his crew.
So let me ask you, a lot of your battle reports tend to say, I had one more activation, or I had two more activations, or...
I'm playing a 10 activation list, yeah.
Is it starting to be a game of spam at the moment?
I think right now it is. It's so hard, especially for Rebels, it's so hard in six turns to get an entire unit off to where, you know, as long as I can still grab objectives, as long as I can still put bodies where I need them, even if they're not dealing tremendous amounts of damage, having all those extra activations work really, really well. And until I think we can get some more consistent dice from lists that want to play, and I'll talk about this here in a minute in my game three, that just want to play for the tie and have more points destroyed, I'm not sure that we have a viable list for that yet. And I think we'll get there. I think that will become a viable play style to just say, I just want to tie VPs and blow stuff up. I think the objective grabby lists are so much better that there's not enough good ways to erase squads for the cheap. But kind of talking about that, my game three was Chris Cole from Kingsport. Played X-Wing with him for probably a couple years now. He's a fantastic painter. His models looked amazing. And we played major offensive breakthrough limited visibility. He had three stormtroopers, two snowtroopers, Vader, and an AT-ST. And that list was terrifying. I use limited visibility on this kind of clustered urban board as we're kind of in kitty corner from each other to move up and avoid any shots turn one. He puts his AT-ST really far forward, but forgets about limited visibility on the first turn. So he was kind of out of position to what he wanted to do. But he made up for it turn two because he pretty much held an entire flank with just Vader and an AT-ST and then sent all of his troopers kind of around the other center the center cluster of buildings that were in our setup. I then take a couple of snowtroopers right off the board really quickly, both of his groups of snows, and I think another group of stormtroopers with my flamethrowers and my, what I'm calling the Slowoski Special Fleet Troopers with the blast, pierce one, just a billion dice. I think I rolled seven hits like three or four times with them over the course of this tournament with no cover and pierce one, so it was pretty nasty. And the game then after turn two, I was feeling excellent. I was up like four activations. I was feeling great. Luke had taken a little bit of damage because he had prioritized taking Luke down with his AT-ST. Vader was running around saber throwing AT-RTs and force choking units when he could. I didn't have heavy weapons near him, so that was a little cost inefficient, but he was getting his value down. And then my dice just went cold. And the dice turned on me. He was rolling pretty good attack dice. I couldn't rally or throw a defense dice to save my life. And he starts to absolutely decimate. And going into turn six, I had like three trooper models spread across two groups, a two-hit point Leia, and an AT-RT that couldn't move and wasn't in a deployment zone. But what I managed to do was he activated Vader first, and I managed to move one of my units into his deployment zone. They drew Vader down back into his own deployment zone so he could, well, I don't know what Vader's keyword is, move and get his free attack to kill him. And then he force choked the last guy, so it was literally just Leia and like an AT-RT left. And he still had a full group of stormtroopers to go and another smaller group of stormtroopers, I want to say. But they were quite a ways away from Vader. And I managed to get Leia to, using her environmental gear, to run out from the cover she was behind and tag Vader, get into base-to-base contact with Vader on the last turn, and his stormtroopers weren't close enough to a single action move and attack to get into base-to-base to join the melee. So even though he had a huge military advantage, he had spent absolutely zero actions trying to move towards my objective or my deployment zone. He had just wanted to kill all my models, and he did a very good job at it. But I managed to get one unit into the deployment zone and win the game, taking top spot, keeping the stab dominance in Kingsport.
I love running into melee just to dodge range attacks. Oh God, don't shoot me. I'm standing next to your commander.
I shouldn't find it funny, but I wanted to see how Chris was going to respond when I do that. I kind of saw him furrow his brow and then turn his head to the side as he kind of put the pieces together that he couldn't kill me. And I feel kind of bad because it is a dirty trick, but it's a dirty trick within the rules. And I don't feel bad because it's a play that I had set up. I had moved those really almost dead troopers into a place just to draw Vader away into the zone so I could get Leia where she needed to be and keep her safe. And so we processed that for a minute afterwards. He was a really good sport about it because he thought he had the game locked and loaded. And I knew I just needed to make sure Leia could double move to get where she needed to go and pull the win.
So that means you're 3-0?
I'm 3-0, and there's another 3-0. But my main man, Scott from Knoxville, who I rode up there with, manages to get paired up because there were three undefeateds going into the last round and win. So I was the only 3-0 at the tournament because my wingman came in and toppled Josh to secure me the top spot. So I owe Scott some coffee or something. It was a really good day. We had a good time. Eric put on a great event, a really almost even spread, I want to say, of Rebels and Imperials. Everybody seemed to have a really good time and definitely can't wait to go back for their next one.
Well, I've only got one more question. Eric's boy, your Padawan, your recruit.
Yeah, Micah didn't do as great as I would have liked. I think he went 1-2 on the day. I think Eric cheated and paired him up against himself. He wanted to beat his own boy in round 3 so he could feel good about himself. It was super dirty. Because we'll talk about this next episode because we have to. Eric was the blue player on key positions. And if you were at our Twitch stream, you know how I feel about that. We'll talk about that later. So it was a really fun event. Eric did a good job, despite the fact that he had to beat the tar out of his own kid to make himself feel good.
Shaming Eric. All right.
Yeah, that's what we're doing. No, Eric knows that we love coming up to his events. It was disappointing that I was the only one who could make it, but I think you had a school function and Will had to work. So me and Scott went and took, I think, 1st and 3rd, but we all know Scott got 2nd in our hearts for winning the pair-up match.
Our boy Scott.
Our thanks to Eric of the Sunsphere North.
Yeah, Sunsphere North. Thanks, Eric. They're called something else, but we're just going to call them Sunsphere North for now. So, yeah, that was my battle reports. It was a really fun 2 weeks of Legion, and I can't wait to get out there again.
Well, speaking of great battle reports, let's go back to this continuing conversation we've had about creating the battlefield. We've looked for the past couple of weeks at some setups, so let's take a look at this week's battle cards. Will, what's our deployment?
All right, our deployment this week is Disarray.
Otherwise known as the best one ever.
For some people. Yeah, this one's that crazy one that your first instinct is to put back in the box because it looks complicated. But it can be a lot of fun. It's just crazy. Having to coordinate your forces between the two opposite corners, it boggles your mind a little bit, and that's why I think it's a lot of fun. For Imperial players, watch out on this deployment, because Rebels with flamethrowers or fleet troopers, they can get to you really quickly, as I learned.
Yeah. With my AT-RT, if you go from like the edge of the deployment zone down the long edge of the map, you can get within range 1 of your opponent's deployment zone in 3 moves. So you can double move, shoot into turn 2.
Yep. And it's pretty gross.
It's terrifying to me because I tend not to run 2 commander list. And so I'm always like, well, who's going to get left beside? Because you're required to put at least 1 unit on the opposite side. And so your best bet on that is to put your vehicles on one side because they don't get panicked. And then put your troopers with your commander on the other. And hope that works out for you.
I think Disarray is the most fun deployment in the game. It plays to my style, the way that I like to play the game, by creating all these little micro skirmishes as you kind of fan out from everywhere. It's a really fast, like it gets to the action very quickly, very fast. But the thing that I like about it the most is I will dare say, and I don't think you can say this about every objective, this deployment plays well with every objective. Intercept transmissions is a madhouse on this map. Recover supplies, the boxes can be like in a cross formation with like one in the middle, or they can all be kind of clustered. They can be all kinds of crazy places. Breakthrough melts your brain because you have so many different places that you can try to crisscross to get into your opponent's deployment zone. And key positions. If you're blue, you're going to win. If you're red, you're going to lose.
Everyone just goes counterclockwise. You just move from here, go counterclockwise across the map.
Yeah. And so I think every objective plays on it really, really well. It really does fit all kinds of different play styles. Like, it fits mine really well, but if you want to play like an AT-ST list, like, it's a great list to, or a great deployment just to throw your AT-ST over in that one corner. And if you angle your arc right, you can hit just about everything you need to, and it can kind of overwatch everything on the board. It's great for bikes. It's great for double commander lists. Like Ben said, single commander lists, it just means you have to stack one deployment zone with all your troopers. But I think it's a really neat game. And even if you are playing a single commander list and disarray is going to be played, try to use your vetoes to get something like key positions or breakthrough, to where the fact that your forces may not be concentrated or maybe more concentrated than you want them to doesn't matter as much. But it always turns into this really weird three-front game where you're fighting, you know, between all these different deployment zones and all these little micro skirmishes. It by far, to me, produces the most fun, frantic games. I like it a lot, if you can't tell.
My only two experiences with it, both the times, I think Vader scared all my people off the board. So I was like, yep, and there they go.
That was on the 3x3, 500
points. Yeah, that was a short map. It was, yeah. Next thing I know, Vader was there. I was like, oh, God, and scared off the board.
Yeah, I want to say out of my six tournament games over the past couple weeks, four of them were on disarray, because I prioritized it that much in the veto phase. And that's something that you have to consider. Like, when it comes to those vetoes, I think you're either going to be gunning for disarray or you're going to be gunning to get rid of it. I don't think you're ever going to shrug and be like, it's disarray.
Ryan, what's our objective?
We are talking this week about recover supplies. Put a bunch of boxes on the board, put one in the middle, everybody else gets two. Grab boxes, move them around, and try to stay alive.
It's the one I consistently see misplayed most often. People are like, oh yeah, I see that box, and I tag it, making it active, and then they leave it. Like, no one ever actually looked up the claim, and it's in the rules guide.
Yeah, you take it with you.
Yeah, you take it with you. Pick up that crate and move, trooper unit. Come on, go, go, go.
Recover supplies, I think I touched on it when I talked about me and Ryan's game. Vader's 2-pip, new ways to motivate, can really give you a swingy turn one where I think on a more standard deployment, you could get two squads to run up grab on that first round with a double move grab, suffering a wound.
To follow up that point, Leia's No Time for Sorrows can achieve a similar goal.
Yeah, and it puts a lot of pressure on your opponent, because that means that next round, they're going the opposite direction, back into cover. The three guys huddling with their box, like, the precious.
My last game at Adepticon, that's exactly what my opponent did. And I was like, what? Wait, what? And then he just booked it, just ran. And I spent the rest of the game chasing that guy down. Come back here with that box.
Once you've got him. Yeah, so it causes a lot of interesting scenarios where I've had two, like, trooper units in melee over a box, and it's just... it's fun to imagine that scenario playing out. So,
yeah, I think out of the four objectives we get in the core box, this is the one that is most list determinant. It favors trooper lists pretty heavily, because there's five objectives. You're bringing six sets of troopers, and you, like, a trooper can carry more than one box, but you kind of want to rush out to them. And it also really favors double commander lists, because if you can get your commanders carrying boxes and they tend to have a few more hit points and be a little bit more resilient than groups of troopers, having somebody extra that can pick stuff up is usually really handy. So I think when you see recover supplies in your deal for battle cards, you really need to make an early play or an early decision. Is this something I want, or is this something I want to, like, actively maybe even burn both of my vetoes to make sure doesn't happen? Does or doesn't happen. It can be a really polarizing game depending on your list. I think if you've got more troopers, more commanders, or better ways of dishing and recovering suppression, if you can say that you've got an advantage on your opponent over on two of those three things, it's a pretty safe bet you want to play it. If you don't have advantage in two of those categories, you should probably do your best to try to flip it down.
Get rid of it.
Yeah. It can be really tough. Like, key positions you can use vehicles for, intercept transmissions just turns into a bloodbath, breakthrough everything scores for as long as it's mobile. But this one, you really need a lot of, what I like to call, a lot of units that have knuckles. Not every unit in the game has knuckles that can pick things up. So you want lots of knuckles.
So our last battlefield card for today is Clear Conditions. Honestly, it's kind of nice if it pops up really early, because it's going to either, if your opponent wants to do something different, they're going to have to veto it. They're going to have to spend one of those to get rid of it if they want to go to, you know, hazardous conditions or, you know, something that affects the game more. Sometimes it's not bad having clear conditions. It's a nice thing to let, oh, good, I don't have to worry about it. We'll let that sit there.
Yeah, I mean, if there's other options in that lineup that are going to hamper your list, like if you have a lot of long-range firepower and limited visibility comes up and you're panicking all over, clear conditions can be really nice.
The only time I play clear conditions is when it shows up or my opponent elects to have it and I really need my vetoes elsewhere. Like if I'm red player and key positions comes up, I have to do everything in my power to make sure that goes away. Or if I really want a particular deployment over another and clear conditions, like, just as kind of meh and I don't have the means, it's not worth the resources to get rid of it. If I do have an extra ban or veto that I don't feel that I really need to save for something else, I typically don't like to play it, because I think you can try to grab a condition that will help leverage your army's strength. And I think all the ones that come in the core box favor the way that I like to play, which is why it's there for players who are running heavy vehicle lists that, you know, don't have to worry about the bravery or the suppression that my 10 activations can put out, or that can drop from the sky, or that can keep me safe as I move my short range units into play. So I typically don't really like it. So if you're playing a list like me, you just kind of play it when you need to make sure something else happens. But if I have a free veto, I tend to get rid of it, because I think it takes a lot of strength away that you can try to leverage your game plan around. Probably of all the conditions, I like it the least. I know I'm supposed to feel neutral on it because it just says no effect, but I actually really quite dislike it.
I think there are people that don't like hazardous conditions or the long range block. It bothers them to have that, and I think they spend their vetoes on those two things. And so that's okay. It forced your opponent to spend a veto someplace else.
Yep, absolutely.
Let's talk about our social media, the Ugly Models contest winners.
Yay!
We had some very great, terrible submissions to our Ugly Model contest. On the Empire front, gentlemen, if you take a look at your folder, take a look at that. That's Jason Belst's Imperial Unit Commander. Had a nice purple theme, and Ryan and I are both lovers of the color purple in our models. Had a nice grassy base.
It's true.
But then it looks like he got dropped into a Chewbacca pit. Just beat about the head and shoulders. The cod piece there, the legs look like he's just been worn to pieces here. So the face, did he fall on a grinder? I don't know what's going on with that face. So Jason, you're our winner for the Imperial side. So we're going to send you a beautiful, beautiful Vader provided to us by Dustin Harvey at Jagged Brush Studios. On the Rebel side, we had Eric Schmidt's repulsive Green Bay Packers theme.
Boo.
Hey.
Anathema to all that Ryan Slowoski's proud Minnesota Vikings heritage believes in.
Yep. It is the ugliest model I've ever seen. Not just because it's green and yellow, but...
Yeah, but it's got a blue vest on.
Yeah.
It's got a hoodie, but he also has no faces. People in Wisconsin have faces, Eric. You live there now. You know that. I once painted an Imperial Assault R2-D2 in Favre's jersey colors and the number just as a junk droid so I could get Ryan to play it on the table so we could shoot at it. And that wasn't enough. Ryan refused to put it on the table.
Nope, didn't go on the table. I do think this contest is a little unfair, because even though these are our ugly contest winners, both of them are better than what I can paint. So congrats to you guys. You're still better painters than me.
We can't give you the prizes.
No, we can't give you the prizes. That's true. That'd be cheating.
So gentlemen, contact us in private messages on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram to find out how to claim your beautiful painted minis. I'm going to have to find a way to ship them so they don't break or melt in the summertime heat. So send me some addresses and we'll get them to you.
Speaking of Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram, give us a follow. We are at STABcast on all those various platforms. Ben posts a lot of pictures to Instagram. We try to keep regular updates on what we're working on or what games we're playing. It'd be really great if you give us a follow. If you're listening to us on iTunes, we'd really appreciate a positive rating. It helps us be more visible on the storefront and hopefully reach more people.
You can also check out our shirt shop on Teespring if you want some cool STABcast swag. Anything we make on there just goes to paying hosting costs for the podcast. We'd also love to get some Q&A action at our email. So you can email us at swstabcast@gmail.com. The other cool place that we're I'm trying to find a regular time to do, but right now that isn't happening, on our Twitch channel. We're really close to getting 50 followers. We'd love to get 50 followers to help get us to the next status with Twitch at STABcast. We'll stream tabletop simulator games, and maybe we'll be able to do some live tournament streaming one day if I can get my equipment worked out. Give us a follow there. We'd love to have you on when we do some tabletop sim matches. We streamed the Invader League semifinals. Sadly, I didn't get to catch the finals or the bronze match when they were played. But the Invader League is done. The top four were all Rebels. Congrats to Kingsley for taking it down. And it was a really cool showing. You can go to our Twitch channel and find the VOD of the semifinal matches. We had a lot of fun despite all the tech issues. And give us a follow there. It'd be awesome. As for the Invader League, you should check out the Legion Discord. They're going to be doing it again, probably in early to mid-August. Details will be coming out soon. But you should definitely go over there. It's a great place to have, you know, list topical discussions and show off paintings. And it's a cool place to get together and gather and talk about everything Legion. So we're a little late on this news cycle, but I think it's a perfect opportunity to have a duel. We had a duel in our battle reports between me and Will, but let's have another Rebel versus Imperial duel between Han and Boba. We don't have a whole lot of details on them, but we do have enough to make it interesting and to talk about. Han and Boba, two new commanders, kind of? How do we feel about the operative word? We haven't really talked about this. They've included a new status of an operative that Boba Fett will fill.
I really like it. I think it's an interesting way to bring in people who, you know, Boba's not a leader of men, but he is a force on the battlefield. So I think it's an interesting position that would have been awkward in the HQ role. So I like it where it is.
He's more expensive than bikes, but he's cheaper than an AT-ST. He flies around the board as fast as he wants to, and he has command cards. So, I mean, I see that positive of, oh, look, he can do something different if I just want to have one commander, as my Imperial list tend to do.
Right.
This guy will do some extra things there, because sometimes I don't want to play that card.
Right.
And so having the ability to do something, you know, with Boba Fett is fantastic.
Well, with the inclusion of the operative, I'm actually really excited for something that I've wanted for a while now, is that we're going to kind of get like a little mini deck builder game when you build your list now, because it's not just going to be your, you know, if you're bringing two commanders and an operative or two, you now have to like custom build your deck of command cards. And it's not just going to be like, well, I brought Luke's three cards, Leia's three cards, and standing orders. We're going to give some options on ways to change things around. On the other side of the table, we've got Han, who has the capability of being a commander. And the promo cards that we were given for Han at Adepticon have him labeled as a special forces unit. But the preview article has him as a commander, and he comes with command cards. So I'm anxious to see if we're going to get Commander Han as well as Operative Han, if they'll move him over into that operative role. And just back in March, they weren't quite ready to talk about operatives yet.
Mm-hmm.
But I think most of his command cards aren't super helpful to your other units of the two that we have.
I beg to differ. I think one of them is super helpful to other units. His 2-pip card orders himself and one other unit, and it says you basically have to attack a unit with a face-up order, and you want them to shoot Han because Han's defense is so good. We'll get into their stat lines here in a minute, but he's going to be incredibly hard to bring down, especially if the non-commander version of him that we got a promo card for, whether that ends up being a special forces or a operative, or it's nothing, who knows, it could just be a misprint, does indeed get the red defense die, and then Commander Han might get the white defense die, because we've got the promo card showing us one thing and the FFG news article showing us something else. So it'll be interesting to see. One thing to note about operatives is they don't get to share, even though they have high leadership, they don't get to share their bubble. And I think that's probably a huge drawback to them, which might make Han a little stronger if you are bringing him as a commander over Boba, who's just never going to run away. But he doesn't help other people either. So, Will, what do you think Boba's biggest strength is?
I just think Boba's going to be a jack of all trades on the battlefield. He is covered in keywords, and basically he does whatever he wants. Arsenal, I think, is crazy on just having a figure model with arsenal. and he's got the weapons to do it with. He's rolling two black dice for either one. One gets pierced, the other gets impact. It's not a huge die pool, but it's going to hit because he surges to crits.
Well, yeah, but with that arsenal keyword, you can roll, up to five dice, four dice maximum?
It would be four.
That's for a single activation? Like, we have lightsabers that do that, but not ranged units.
It would be four black dice, impact one, pierce one.
Yeah. Even Han has only got two red dice. While Boba Fett can unload all kinds of dice into one individual, Han does have Gunslinger to where he can shoot. He has to shoot at multiple targets if they're within range at range 1-2. But he has Pierce 2, which I think is super cool because that means defense dice don't matter.
Yeah.
It's going to be awesome.
It's like when you throw Vader's saber and they pick up their defense. You're like, no, you don't need those.
You don't need those. Yeah. So obviously, Luke and Vader will still get defense dice because they're immune to Pierce. And I think out of both of these guys, the thing that I'm really excited to see how FFG uses in the future is that Boba Fett keyword that lets him roll extra dice equal to Pierce.
Mm-hmm. Impervious.
Impervious. Thank you.
If they have a Pierce X, you roll X additional defense dice.
I would love to see a gear upgrade that gives that keyword to units. That would be like if you could give a commander or even a trooper squad like some extra armor, that would be super, super cool. Boba Fett's covered in keywords. Han's covered in keywords. Han's got low profile, meaning if he's got light cover from like a suppression, he gets heavy cover. He's got gunslinger, which means when he attacks, he takes two attacks, but they have to be on different targets. He's got sharpshooter one, meaning he ignores one rank of cover. And he's got uncanny luck, meaning he can reroll three defense dice every time he's shot at. He's going to be hard to bring down.
If he gets the red die, like the preview card that we got at Adepticon, that's crazy. Because he surges for a block as well.
Yeah, I don't think he will. I think this might be a misprint. Or maybe it wasn't misprinted when they made the card, but maybe so. Because the commander version that they have on the website has the white die, but this special forces version that they gave us has a red die. So maybe you trade a leadership bubble for a better die. Who knows?
Another thing about Boba Fett is he has something called Bounty. It's going to be the first real way to earn victory points outside of your deployment mission cards. And basically you pick an enemy commander or operative. And if you kill them and then Boba's alive at the end of the game, you just gain one additional victory point, which is crazy.
I think that's such a cool design space. I think that's a great ability for Boba Fett, but I can't wait to see what else comes out with other ways to score objective points that your opponent has no control over.
I think the biggest thing we're not talking about is that this a trooper unit that can move three.
Yeah, that's huge.
He just darts around the board. He's got jump two. He clears any terrain that he wants to look at. Leaps the tallest building. Is it a bird? Is it a plane? No, it's Boba Fett.
I think we'll be very hard-pressed to find terrain that's higher than two and makes a good battlefield. So I think he'll be able to just kind of go wherever he pleases. But yeah, Han's a little slower. He's a little shorter range, but he's got that leadership bubble. He gets to reroll his defense dice. He can shoot twice. That double red die attack is going to be so good. I think they both come with really cool cards in their packs that are going to change the way we get to play the game. I think Duck and Cover is a must on Han. The card we're getting with the, I think, both sets of special forces and Han that lets you, before you roll defense dice, take a suppression token to give yourself cover if you don't already have one. And since he has low profile, it's going to give him cover two whenever he needs it, so you'll never be able to catch him out, which is going to be awesome. As opposed to, you know, I think it kind of counters Boba's impervious. I think it's going to be super cool, and I like how these two figures are going to play very different from one another.
But they're both going to contrast the other as well. So like when they're fighting each other, they do kind of have answers to the other's abilities. The whipcord launcher for Boba Fett, I think, is going to be interesting. Basically lets him wrap up a unit that's engaged him and, you know, run away. It's a free action. You select them, they gain two immobilized tokens and two suppression. We don't have a card saying what immobilize does, but the card that gives the immobilize also says Boba can just disengage for free while they have one or more immobilized. So probably going to limit movement.
I would imagine so. Han gets to shoot first, which is pretty rad, and it gives him aim and dodge tokens. But I like the other command card that we kind of already talked about that lets him draw fire to himself. I can't wait to play that card and order Han and Leia, and then have Leia go first to flip her command token down, giving Han a dodge token. And then you just, until I activate Han, you just have to shoot him. It's going to be so cool. So, Ben, we've made our cases here for Han and Boba. You play both. Who are you most excited for and why?
I think it's got to be Boba Fett. And it's not because I'm a Star Wars nerd and I love the idea of a Boba Fett. We were joking earlier, but it looks like I can paint it and then drop it a couple times. It's okay. Because it's Boba Fett. He's supposed to be scratched up a bit. I love the Hunter upgrade on him that you can place on him, but you also place on others. If you're taking a shot at a trooper and they've already been damaged once, here's an aim token. So nice free reroll just for doing stuff. The speed of him, the surges on him, he gets two upgrade slots for 140 points. That's a great value. It is. It's a great value. It range 1 to 2. 4 black dice.
I'll just have to work extra hard to prove you wrong.
Now, I mean, I love myself some Han Solo. I do. But I think right now, I gotta say it's Boba.
I am really excited for both of these models. My dream would be for them to have the exact same street date, especially if we do get an operative version of Han. That's my dream, so I could run Luke, Leia, and Han all together, even though that is giving up two activations. But we'll see. It'll be fun.
We've had long-range communications from our allies at FFG. They have published an official forum version of the FAQ, which we've not really seen them do it in this format before.
It's new and interesting.
I think I understand why they've done it. They've always been very slow on FAQs. They have been. And there's been a lot of communication with Alex Davey as, what can I do about this? And you'll see on the internet, well, I saw an email that said this, and I saw an email that said that. And my grandma called him up, and she said it was this thing. And
yeah, no one was playing on the same page because everybody had seen different emails. Even though the emails were probably consistent with each other, they weren't always collected all in the same place. And so I think they've rolled this out for all of their competitive games, where they're going to have on their official forums like a locked thread that's going to serve as their FAQ before they take the time to update the living rulebook, that because they've told us we're not going to get a Legion FAQ. They're just going to update the rulebook, which is cool, which is rad. I like that. So if you guys haven't looked at this, you guys should go to their forums and check it out. But we've each picked one of the clarifications that we think was really needed and worth talking about. And for me, it was what to do with suppression from standby and recover actions. Like, if I take my first action and then someone spends a standby token and suppresses me, do I get my second action? Or if I spend my first action to recover, I no longer have any suppression, do I get my second action now? And that was like a bit of confusion. And now they've made a very clear answer that immediately after you make your roll to rally, you check to see if you get one or two actions with the amount of suppression you have against your bravery. And even if you clear and or gain suppression, you still get that same number of actions. So if you do move in and get suppressed from a standby token, you can still take a second action. And even if you are suppressed and you take a rally action, then you don't get a second action. And I like how it's very clean. It's very concise. Like, you check, you see how many actions you get, you move on. I love that that's been clarified, because that was a persnickety little rule that everybody had a different answer to.
I love early games like this. I've never seen that happen before. Well, let's consult the Google, or let's see what we can figure out this thing says. It lays it out very nicely in a step-by-step format.
My ruling that I think is most interesting is that if you have an AT-ST in melee, you can use its arsenal keyword to perform a ranged attack and a melee attack. I hadn't really thought about it, I guess, which is why I thought it was really cool. Just the fact that you can't tie down vehicles just means you shoot over them and then stomp them with one action, which I don't think I'd seen anyone do with their melee AT-STs.
Yeah, I've had some Rebel Troopers stepped on before.
I've used melee with it, but I didn't think to use arsenal to also shoot.
Oh, gotcha. Right. Yeah, the only thing is, I don't think you can shoot people who you're touching. But with arsenal, you don't care. You're happy to shoot multiple targets and put out multiple suppression.
For me, it was the cumbersome savior question. When a unit spends a standby token to perform an attack, can it use a weapon that has a cumbersome keyword, even though it moved in the activation previous? Turns out you can. And that's fantastic, because it's no longer your activation. You're done. So if the standby comes up, then you get to do that. And so I think right now that we're looking at two things that have some cumbersome, the HH-12 missile launcher and the brand new E-Webs. And so with the new E-Webs, oh, that ruling's fantastic.
Right. And they even call that out in the news article, and we'll get to that here in a minute. But I think for me, it sets a really nice precedent for you only have to keep things in mind for a unit's activation. You don't have to rewind time and try to, like, I could easily see arguments come up. No, this unit moved last turn. It didn't move this turn, so I can shoot with this weapon on this standby token, because that standby token may be sitting there for 15, 20 minutes. If you do it early in the round, it doesn't trigger till late. You don't have to remember who did what for an entire course of a round. You just get to tie a bow on it and say it can go now.
Which makes it really nice to stand there, refresh, standby. As long as you're within range, you don't have to move a whole lot. Cumbersome doesn't become quite as cumbersome as it used to be.
Yeah.
So speaking of the E-Web, let's sneak down to Imperial Corner and let's see what Will thinks about it.
Right, the E-Web. I've gotten a few questions about this. I know from our inquisitive friend Brett, who should send his questions via email. The E-Web is interesting. I like that it's cheap. I like that it's 55 points for a die pool that's one red die short of a bike. That's not bad. The fact that it retains movement really helps, unlike some people who have to stay still with their turrets. Spoilers.
Spoiler alert.
The one issue I see is whether it's worth the points, honestly. Like, it is cheap, but how much effect it will have on the game, I cannot say yet. I need some time with it.
I think it is. Going back to talking about my game against Chris Cole, is it has knuckles. It can pick up stuff. I think that's huge. Unlike the thing lurking in the Rebel Cave that can't contest objectives, this thing can. Even if it's just a key position that's right outside your deployment zone, you can spend one move action to move up and touch it, and you're good.
Yeah, I think that might be what its saving grace is.
I think that you can do Sentinel standby at range 3 with that dice pool. Yeah, I think it's amazing. You're one red die short and two health short of a bike. But you also don't have the damage that comes with it, you know, being a vehicle. And you get to pick up boxes.
Yeah, I think with standby, you could really project this like range 3 bubble of, is it worth kind of coming into this bubble to, you know, take that suppressive fire? Because even if someone triggers your standby, you don't have to shoot at that unit. So if there's another unit near them in range 3 that hasn't activated yet or something, you could put some suppression on them or do all sorts of stuff. So I think it's going to be a good unit.
For that cost, I just love it. Love it. Well, let's link down into Rebel Cave. And what prizes did FFG bring you?
We got the dumbest named unit so far to hit Legion, the 1.4 FD laser cannon team. We're going to have to find some colloquialism for that. I just kind of want to call it the FU laser cannon team. It's a big turret. It can't move. It's got range 4, which is cool. I think this is the first Rebel unit that we've got that can hit range 4, with the exception of the heavy laser cannon on the AT-RT, which is so specialized. You don't really get to use it that much at range 4 because you don't want to shoot many troopers with it. You know, I wasn't too big on this unit. And then one night I sat down on Tabletop Simulator and I just sat there and I measured range 4 from all the different deployments that we currently have. And it's okay. Like, you can hit a good chunk of the battlefield. It's not as bad as I thought it was going to be, a bad of a limiting factor, the fact that it can't move. You're going to have to be very careful where you deploy it. And I think you're going to have to make sure that you get a deployment zone that has some cover in it that you can put it up against to really keep it safe. Otherwise, it's just going to get blown off the battlefield. But it has something that I've been asking for an incredibly long time. And it has access to the suppressive keyword. So this thing's going to be able to throw a bunch of dice out, putting two suppression tokens down to really help control the battlefield. The other thing that I really like about it is it takes the spot of an AT-RT, and so it's still not pulling off the gas pedal of your objective control from troopers. It's not like you're replacing a Rebel trooper team with it. You're just replacing an AT-RT who had a very difficult time taking objectives anyway. It did a good job about denying objective, but not taking them. So the thing that you've got to keep in mind with these guys is they're about roughly with upgrades and such the same cost as an AT-RT. They fill a very different role. I see people taking one of them. Maybe we can see spam of them come down once we get to more of a kill team format where we're playing just for, like I said, earlier in the episode, that denial game. But I don't see them really getting spammed yet. But they're more expensive than you think because I think you need a bid. I think if you're going to bring one, or even more so, if you're going to bring more of these, you really need to bring an initiative bid. Because you need to make sure you can get the deployment zone, the deployment area that you want, and the objectives control that you want to make sure you get to play something where your heavy laser cannon turret, your 1.4 FD laser cannon team can really hold their ground on. Because you know what? You don't want these guys on breakthrough. So if you're going to take them, be sure to factor in at least probably a three, at bare minimum, a 3 to 5 point bid, if not more.
I think if you're taking an AT-RT with a laser cannon because you fear an AT-ST or, you know, maybe an enemy T-47, although if you remember last week's episode, I don't like the T-47 anymore.
You shouldn't be afraid of an enemy T-47.
The AT-RT with the laser cannon is 90 points, and you only get three dice, a red and two blacks. Where if you're playing with the laser cannon team with the barrage generator, I mean, you're sitting at 80 points, and you're throwing five black dice and two white dice to apply suppressive.
Yep.
I mean, granted, if you're shooting AT-ST, you don't need to apply the suppression, but that's a lot of damage with impact two at, you know, range four, which an AT-ST can't do. It likes to do is mortars, but it's not really doing that much damage with those mortars.
Its main gun is range four.
But also, if you're afraid of vehicles, you could slap on the other upgrade that gives it an additional black die and another rating of impact.
Yeah, so you're throwing six black dice with impact three, which will tear apart AT-RTs, absolutely tear them apart. So I don't know. I'm anxious to really get this thing to the table and experiment with it. But I think the highlight of it is this thing is going to be so easy to paint, y'all. Like, I'm going to be able to slap this thing together in an hour. I'm excited about that.
Another thing about it is it's our first real spotting of Hoth Trooper minis. So that could be in the works.
Yeah, I'm assuming before too long, we'll get Echo Base Troopers that'll be, you know, Rebel versions of Snow Troopers.
Now, I know there's someone out there who's like, I'm going to buy all of these laser cannons so I can take these Hoth Trooper minis and I'll make my own Hoth Trooper minis teams. Just hold on. FFG will bring it to you, I promise.
I was going
to
say, isn't that you?
No, God, no, heavens no, heavens no. I don't need that much veracity in my battlefields. So. Let's take this to the unaligned systems, because I think the best card that came out of all of that is something that can apply to all sorts of things now, and that's the HQ uplink.
Yeah, it's amazing.
For 10 points, it goes in a comm slot. You're forced to exhaust it, but during the issue order steps of the command phase, issue an order to yourself. So it doesn't matter what command card you use, you get to give that particular unit a command token, an order token. And that is amazing, because there are so many things that have a comm slot.
I can't tell you how many times I've had to play a command card, and my flamethrower AT-RT has been in range one of a unit, but out of commander range, or since I'm playing Rebels, a lot of those command cards can only issue orders to troopers. And so I have to play Go Fish and try to fish that AT-RT out before my opponent can react and move those troopers away. Getting to be able to like aim and flame right off the bat is huge. I will pay 10 points for that every day, even if I only use it once every day of the week.
Sometimes I want a Son of Skywalker, but I only get Luke. And so it would be great. Oh, now I can take this AT-RT and do something, be ready with it rather than go fish. Because I have so many trooper units. When I don't want to draw my AT-RT, I draw it. And when I want to draw it, I can't find the stupid token.
How is this going to play out for Imperials, Will?
That's the thing. I'm not seeing a lot of great uses for it. I mean, bikes would appreciate it, but I think long-range comms would do just as well, because I think we do have, for Veers, a card that is specifically for ordering vehicles.
Right.
So I think it helps out Rebels more. Maybe I could see it on an AT-ST, just that one big turn. You want to get it up to go.
What about an AT-ST with Weiss, who also has to refresh? So instead, so you can just like shoot refresh every turn, and then you've got Arsenal 3, and you're always ordered to move whenever you have to.
I mean, it could work. I agree with your viewpoint that it's way better on the AT-RTs than on most of the Imperial vehicles, but who knows? We might get one later on that'll really help out with that card.
Yeah, who knows?
The fact that you can put it on a trooper unit. We haven't really talked about them, but the scouts and the rebel commandos, they get a comms unit. And so you just traditionally want those guys kind of out and about by themselves. We still don't know what the bomb thing does. So maybe that allows you to be like, oh, and then he placed the bomb.
Yeah, who knows? It'll be interesting to see, though. The thing that I think it will really do, at least for rebels on the rebel commandos, is a lot of my extra cards, like Luke and Leia's cards, let them do things specifically when troopers receive an order. And so now, if I have that available, I'll be able to tap it and use it to activate another, order another unit with my allies, the Force, or No Time for Sorrows, or Somebody's Got to Save Our Skins, to get extra bonuses out of that. Getting to use three or maybe even four units with speed one moves on No Time for Sorrows could break the game. You're paying lots of points for it, but it could break the game.
Just getting that extra order token out means you don't have to worry about the randomness of the pull.
Yeah, and I think it could also really help with Vader's new ways to motivate him, giving him a long-range option to murder people to make them work harder.
I really think what keeps this card from being super bonkers is that it is that you have to exhaust it to use it.
Yep.
Otherwise, it's just crazy.
Yeah, luckily it isn't exhaust. I think that's okay. I still think it's worth its points. Like, it's not an always on order. I like things in these games that make you make decisions instead of just always being on and always being active. They're things you have to plan and set up for.
But when you have mandatory movement, that's kind of a free place to use a refresh because you've already moved.
Yep. So the other big piece of FFG news, which I was like super delighted to hear, we have incoming new bases that you can rip all your models off of your current bases if you want to put them on ship decks. Yeah, because, you know, that's a thing you might want to do. Will, how do you feel about this?
Well, you know, with my custom-made ship bases, I'm feeling a little salty, FFG.
Y'all spent a lot of time at Adepticon looking at that table and looking at all the different types of deck plating and then doing all that green stuff.
Yes, I did. I don't know. It is tempting to go and get those because they're nice and uniform, whereas mine bother me sometimes because the lines aren't perfectly straight. But I wish they'd been announced earlier.
I find it hilarious.
I know you do.
I think what we'll probably see is we'll see a lot of people who have a particular aesthetic in mind who may not have the hobby skills to create it themselves. Are probably going to play with a lot of unbased minis for a while, waiting to see if whatever terrain they are looking for is going to get published by FFG. Honestly, I'm glad they're doing deck plating as opposed to like sand and snow that you can so easily do with just flock. I hope we get to see like really heavily textured bases that would be not just a quick, you know, glue and sprinkle kind of deal.
Ones that are harder to reproduce using your own methods that you worked really hard to source and now have to be frustrated about. But I think it's cool that they're doing that for people who maybe don't have the hobby capacity to do a lot of projects like that.
Right.
It was time intensive for both of you. I remember watching it.
Yeah, and I just found some texture paint for my bases that doesn't like half the time and looks a million times better. It's fun.
Well, right now it looks like the next Legion thing coming out is the Barricades pack coming to stores near you.
Woo! No one cares. Woo-hoo. Absolutely no one cares. Nobody cares. So I think that's about all we've got time for. This has been a little bit longer of an episode, but we wanted to make it up for you guys for having a bit of a delay. So as always, I am Ryan Slawoski for the STABcast. Special thank you to our excellent producer, John Michael. And I'm Ryan reminding you to always run and throw one black die, 8 white dice, 2 red dice with blast and pierce 1 and win the game.
I'm Will Heim. I need more activations. I'm addicted.
And I'm Ben Fowler. Now I have 2 armies, but how am I going to transport and store them at the same time?
Have a good night, everybody.
Good night, everyone.
Good night.
Yep, Ben's going through menopause.
I am. At the male age of 36.